forgotten about it. Yeah. Try that again. No.
Yes.
Try again. I'm about to pour a bit.
Mettez
la sonnette.
Là, c'est une forme de récolte.
Là, nous gagnons 41 années, depuis 1974. Tout ce roche là, tout est bien. Tout est gardé. Tout ce roche est gardé. Si vous n'avez pas de stress là, si vous n'avez pas de bagage là, c'était baissé en un seul. On peut dire pour le compte. Non, ça c'est pour tout. C'est bout de vie, c'est à continuer.
Ah, ouais,
c'est à continuer. Yeah. C'est pas fait bacana hier, c'est pour ça que je ne m'en demande pas pour entrer dedans tout, mais pour agrandir. C'est agrandir. Jusqu'à quoi? Jusqu'à l'état de la vie, mais aller, bon, où laisser pour ça?
Okay.
It's quarter after 4 in the morning on March 5th. We're loaded up and ready to go to Olympia to teach the legislators about the importance of bees.
Ya aquí sí estamos observando un panal de miel totalmente operculado.
Y no ha tenido bastante impacto realmente porque las lluvias se hacen más intensas, más largas, y eso nos afecta en todo lo que es la floración. Más vemos la floración en una época de que ella no estaba impuesto, por ejemplo, en un mes. Un árbol impuesto a florecer en febrero y que florezca en mayo.
Tenemos que alimentarla más, poner estimulante, lo que es el sustituto de polen, para que las reinas sean de altamente calidad.
Beekeeping I've been doing for 20 years. Here we are in the forest, and the only flowers we can find are the flowers of the trees. And the trees, they stop blooming in July. So it's difficult for the bees to store a lot of honey for 6 months.
They're sleeping.
I'm just testing the weight of the hives to know if they have food enough to spend a good winter. I know that 100 years ago, this area was a very good place for honey harvest. The landscape was different. It was only moorlands with heather, and now we are in the forest. We have no more crops, no more peasants. Flowers collecting is very poor. So it's more difficult now to collect honey.
Celle-là, ça va être tranquille, elle a rien fait.
Rien du tout.
Mais la ruche est quasiment vide, donc. Vide de chez vide. Extraordinaire, hein. Rien de rien. Il y a des abeilles, il y a 3 gouttes de miel. Là-dedans, il n'y a rien à extraire.
In 20 years, we have seen a climate change, and I don't know what will happen. For the forest, for the trees, for the crops, what kind of summer will we have? What kind of winters? The bees are not used to very hard weather. They are used to Atlantic climate, and now the climate is changing with strong winters, with very dry summers. I'm not sure they are well prepared to a strong winter.
Les passer dans des ruches neuves pour l'hivernage, et puis je vais leur semer de la moutarde là pour qu'elles fassent des provisions de fin de séjour, quoi. Petite provision d'automne. Là, on est quoi, 4 septembre. Elles ont encore 2 mois à grignoter, à ramasser des trucs. À peu près ça, quoi. Et voilà.
I knew I had to do something. If you protect and enrich the environment, in just a short time, you can make a lot of impact. So that's when I got into honeybees. Once you get into bees, your life changes. Those critters provide the food that we eat. And to see the honeybee as the sentinel of something bigger that's going on right now, It brings trepidation, and it brings pause for concern.
Okay, it's all right. These girls are very quiet, and they're usually a little bit more temperamental. So this might indicate that the queen is in this box as well. The smoke helps to disrupt the alarm pheromone, and it also gets them back down into the boxes so fewer bees get hurt.
Once you start understanding about the colony life of honeybees, it brings out a new understanding in the circle of life. Truly, a colony of honeybees is an organism that's made up of tens of thousands of individuals, but they, as a colony, are an organism, and they communicate and they make decisions as an organism.
So on this frame, you can see on the outside edges, they have the honey. As this was a complete frame of honey going into winter, this high up in the colony, but they've eaten out a section of it, and the queen has already laid brood that has emerged. This is all drone comb down here. And this box is heavy. It's all full of honey. So that's probably 45 pounds of honey in there.
They are on the front line of what humans are doing to the earth. because they're at the very basic level of the ecology between plants and animals, and making that plant source fruitful so that animals can live. Over the last 8 years, we've consistently seen 30 to 40% of the managed honeybees dying in the winter. If we had one or two bad years where the deaths were higher, we could have a pollination disaster. And it can happen, I mean, check out the gray hair. It can happen in my lifetime, in my lifetime.
J'ai décidé de faire apiculture pour deux raisons. C'est parce que j'aime la façon d'abeille organiser pour faire miel là tout. Et puis tout, j'aime apiculture parce que c'est un bagage qui a rentré l'argent. En apiculture, comme si vous parlez un agent dévastateur, vous aimez l'environnement. Ou protéger l'environnement parce qu'on a besoin de pieds bois, besoin de fleurs, besoin de bagailles. Laisse ça ou même ou pas couper pieds bois. Toute la journée, au contraire, on va planter tant pour détruire pieds bois.
Un pile pollen.
La pluie, les nuits extrêmes, nous avons extrait plus. Pendant ces stress-là, il y a un petit genre. Puis petit, même par rapport à. Et yo, là, pour la caille, moi, je fais un genre, mettez de l'eau, mettez une éponge. Et puis, pour mettre de l'eau plusieurs côtés, chaque matin, je lave le vaisseau, puis mettre un mousse sur éponge, de façon pour camper sur éponge là, pour ouvrir de l'eau, juste là, tomber dans de l'eau pour ne pas perdre l'abeille, parce que je suis très sensible pour un grain d'abeille. Donc là, quand je suis là, j'ai un pile pied citron, pied chadette, pied orange, des cailles là qui fait toujours du miel, abeilles toujours en sécurité.
C'est
un citron. Je grandis deux apicultrices.
Trying to let the legislatures know about bees and beekeeping and how important we are for agriculture.
Most people, you know, look at the wings and the crown. They know right off what our agenda is. There's no question about it. Today is the first time that the Washington State Beekeepers has had an awareness building day in Olympia. We worked all year long in 2014 to determine what the major issues are for beekeepers in Washington State. And that is now driving our legislative agenda and a lot of the activities that we have going. We have very large-scale commercial beekeepers, as well as mid-size beekeepers, and me, I'm a very small-scale beekeeper, all committed to the same issues and trying to get the same kinds of support for honeybees in the state.
My name is Tim Hyatt. I'm the oldest son of six who together run Hyatt Honey. It's a business that makes honey and pollinates crops in California, Washington, and North Dakota. My dad and mom started the business in 1968. They were both school teachers, and they decided they wanted something for their boys to do when there wasn't school, and so they moved up here and bought a small beekeeping business. And we've had something to do ever since. So this hive, we were here just a few days ago, and we saw that it had a bad queen. And so we killed the bad queen, and I'm coming back today to give it
a new queen that we purchased. So our queen cage here has sugar candy on one end and an open hole, and it's plugged by the sugar candy. So the bees will consume this, and in a couple days, they'll release the queen. And by then, they should be accustomed to her scent, her pheromone mix, so that they'll accept her, and then she'll be their new queen and start laying and build the population up. At least that's what we hope. The queens don't live as long as they used to anymore. They used to live 3-4 years. It was not uncommon. And now people are reporting less than a year. We're seeing probably more than a year, but not much more. So for whatever reason, we have to maintain the bees all winter long just to keep them alive. And something has changed in the last 40 years or 45 years that my dad has been keeping the bee business and that we've been running it. Something in the environment. The bees themselves have changed. The worker bees aren't living as long as they used to. A few days, but out of a bee that lives 3 weeks in the summer or 4 weeks in the summer, a few days is a big difference. And that lack of longevity for the worker bees translates into the queen having to work a lot harder to keep the population up. She has to lay more eggs. And so she will age prematurely. We call it burnout. So both of those things decrease the longevity of the hive generally. Why that is, I'm sure pesticides have a role to play, the varroa mite and the viruses it transmits, changes in ag practices, less things that are friendly to bees being planted by farmers now. Large-scale noxious weed control has taken away a lot of the natural forage that bees and native pollinators rely on. So there's a lot of factors that contribute to the difficulties that honeybees face. It's been about 10 days since the last rain we had here. But before that, it seemed like every other or every third day. Typically, the rain that you receive in May and June are what you're gonna get for the year. And so these scattered thunderstorms like we had last night, they can really save your crop if you happen to get one. Now, one of the yards we went to first, up by Bowman, got a lot of rain, looked like.
Oh, really?
Big puddles.
North or south of town?
West.
West.
It looks like a lot of the ones I'm putting queens in are pretty wimpy.
Yeah.
So.
Right, and that's the other thing. I don't want to be too hard on them. I mean, because I pull a cage out, and they're still pretty weak, and I'm just, do I replace this queen again, or?
This was sweet clover last year. Yeah, that's what this, it looked like this last year, and this to this year. So the bees are weaker coming into the summer, and it's really late here too. I mean, we're only a week into pulling honey, and it's the 16th of July when we should have been pulling honey. We usually start right after the 4th of July pulling honey.
Experience, the climate has everything to do with bees' health, their vigor, the honey they produce, how well they pollinate. But it has more to do with that year's conditions. We've never seen years that were identical.
The only consistency is that it's inconsistent. You know, it could be hot, it could be cold. I mean, there's just so much in flux. You can't really pin down saying it's hotter, it's colder. I mean, every year is different.
As climate changes over time, whether it's a wet season, a dry season, whether the temperature gets hotter or colder, we just need to be on top of the bees. And so I see the beekeepers today are more aware of climate than they've ever been. Some of the best hives in decades ago were managed by people who never looked at their hives. You could have a laissez-faire attitude, but not so anymore.
But as you can see where, like right here, you had a hive that died, so the boxes are gone. The whole yard, like 1,200,000 bees,
So in the air, you're probably seeing probably 60,000, maybe. I haven't counted them yet, but everybody does things differently. I mean, you know, and even within our company, I mean, every brother on his crew does things differently. It's just, you know, and sometimes you don't like that because it's like, yeah, I want it done my way. You know, the other brother says, no, don't do it that way. Do it my way. So it's a challenge. I'm pretty easygoing, I guess, but some of the other brothers are a little more intense. But everybody wants it their own way, and it's kind of fun. Malita Wancho is Wongo La Caja, ya. Está bien. Mira.
It's the end of the day. The guys are coming in with their honey. They left this morning and they had empty boxes on their truck and they've gone out and checked the bees, put in queens, pulled the honey. Now they're coming back and they're unloading. The honey that they're running now, they bring it right to our uncapper. The cap has to come off. This is what keeps the honey sealed up. And so this frame, okay, con permiso. When we lay it on the machine, it has metal cutters that'll cut it off. Oh, you gotta turn the... Poco más rápido. See, now the frame is all open and that honey's ready to flow out. They fill the machines and they start off really slow. As you can see, it's running. It's packed full of frames and it's just going slow, slow, nothing very fast. And then as the honey goes out, it'll automatically go faster, faster, and faster. On a good year with good honey, we can do 2,000 gallons a day, which is good. So this honey is North Dakota clover. This is why we come all the way over here, to get the good clover honey. Yeah, the U.S. only produces about a third of what we eat, and so we import about two-thirds. So it just doesn't make sense to take much honey out of the country, and we just have to bring more in. We used to do about half. About 15 years ago, we used to do about half the need for honey in the U.S., but now there's not as many beekeepers. The bees, you know, their livelihood and their health has gone down, and so with not as many hives, we just don't produce enough honey.
Nous avons un problème de boisement qui est un gros problème. Si nous avons planté, il faut que nous pensions comment nous avons conservé, planter surtout plantes mellifères que nous avons besoin pour abeilles. Notre mission, c'est accompagner les apiculteurs pour rendre plus productives leurs richesses et porter plus de richesses à leur famille. Donc, nous connaissons un problème qui est grave en Haïti, question de débrasement. Parce que le débrasement vient une source pour un pile de monde pour couper pied bois, faire charbon, pour répondre à un problème économique qu'ils ont gagné.
Avec le phénomène de la coupe des arbres, c'est toujours un problème qui est lié aussi avec la gestion de l'environnement. Ce sont des problèmes qui sont liés aussi avec la situation, les situations économiques des paysans et des agriculteurs. Donc, le fait que le paysan donc, ou l'agriculteur n'a pas suffisamment de moyens pour survivre sa famille, donc il est obligé d'abattre les arbres pour pouvoir procurer soit de l'argent, donc pour vendre, pour faire du charbon et autres. Donc, ça aussi entrave le fonctionnement des abeilles et les profits qu'on peut tirer des abeilles.
Il était plus facile. Mais pour le moment qu'on y est plus cher. De quoi pour me capable de gagner une récolte, me capable vivre avec madame, petite, et pas besoin, pas me vendre avec monde qui a besoin. On a besoin de beaux kits de miel, ou bien de galons de miel, ou bien quelques kilos de miel, et puis on vendre. Ou vendre 80%, ou consommer 20% et 15%. L'autre 5%, ou séparer par les amis, par les familles. Le métier apiculture, c'est un métier secondaire qui est lié. Mais vrai moyen pour capable vivre là, ou gagner l'autre activité, ou faire pour capable vivre, mais le métier apiculture, il vient en deuxième position.
Venez voir, c'est l'autre bagaille, l'autre niveau.
Production du miel en Haïti, avec les problèmes qui sont liés avec les changements climatiques et autres, il y a. Et certains paramètres qu'on n'arrive pas à maîtriser, qu'il y a environ presque 6 mois, donc les plus bas, donc ça affecte l'environnement.
La sécheresse, il y avait ça toujours. Ouais, il y a des mauvais, il y a des bons moments, il y a aussi des mauvais moments. OK? Mais pour cette année, c'est grave. Parce que nous avons plus de 6 mois sans pluie.
6 mois?
6 mois, pas une
pas de la pluie. Ou bien, il y a des problèmes, le changement climatique là. Gede là, moi de me compte bien pile la pluie. Moi j'ai bien pile la pluie. Gode change climatique là qui vient faire temps changer, varier. Ça vient faire nous manquer joindre. Et avec manquer joindre ça boule car point qui capable porter produit pour nous récolter.
Bees don't care about us. They don't care about us getting food. They go to the flower to get the food they need. In that beautiful dance between an insect and a flower, we get food. How food is made and how it comes to us. If people just go to a grocery store and they pick up their produce there, and they never see the interaction between a flower enticing a bee or another pollinator to come to it.
We communicate very well with those who use pollination services. And they're very aware of the importance of bees to their crops. They don't get apples if they don't have bees. They don't set a good seed crop if they don't have bees.
Your trellis is holding up okay?
The trellis is doing great. Every now and then we have to come in and tighten up wires a little bit, but
we are a organic orchard, mainly apples, and we have Granny and Cameo and Galas. A Gala is not gonna pollinize a Gala, so you need not only, you know, bees, but you need a different variety, whether it's a crab apple or a Granny and a Gala, because you need those bees to travel from different flowers and cross-pollinate. So without bees, you know, I wouldn't have a crop of Galas or Grannies, you know. They're just, you know, if I got lucky, maybe I'd have 3 or 4 apples per tree. But these are all the little buds that will soon be apples. The bees do all the work. The first thing that determines how successful of a crop you're gonna have, you know, if you don't get the bees, the apples aren't gonna self-pollinate, and so you won't get any type of fruit set, and you won't have an apple crop. Right over here, it's a crab apple tree, and a crab apple can pollinate another apple tree. As far as apples are concerned, whether it's a crab apple or a Gala or a Granny, it's an apple tree. And so we have every 100 feet or 50 feet, depending on where we're at, we have a crab apple tree that we use for pollinizers. So they take the pollen from there and then they put it into our Galas or our Grannies or our Cameo and they pollinize. These weeds that dry out up on top of the soil.
As we're better able to protect bees by using pesticides carefully, by providing good forage for them, it will tend to help us service the needs of agriculture better and will help ensure a more stable food supply at a stable price.
We had to work a little bit harder than conventional farmers to keep the pest out. And, you know, I know that we work quite a bit with them when we want to spray. You know, we double check anything, you know, that we're going to spray and how it's going to affect the bees that might be in the area still. And, you know, we definitely take that into effect because we don't want to harm any bees that are going to be beneficial to us.
Are these the heavy ones? Yeah, they are. I think that we need to remember that the honeybee is important not for the honey. It's important for the pollination. We can have other sweeteners, and honey's great. It's way better than corn syrup, in my opinion. But the real value of honeybees is their pollination. Without the pollination from bees, you wouldn't have fruit. You wouldn't have berries. Vegetables that we eat are all set by pollinators. The seed is set by pollinators, the onions, carrots, radishes. You wouldn't have so many things in your diet that are so valuable and make your diet more interesting. Remember you were saying, how do I know where all these yards are? Memory, except for the next one, I'm not real sure where it is.